From New York, this is Democracy Now!
On this vote, the yeas are 230, the nays are 197, present is one. Article 1 is adopted.
The House of Representatives impeaches President Trump, making him only the third president to be formally charged with high crimes and misdemeanors under the Constitution. We'll go to Capitol Hill to get response from Congressmember Pramila Jayapal.
Founders entrusted us with the awesome responsibility of protecting our democracy, which gets its power not from the bloodlines of monarchs, but from the votes of we the people. And so today, to uphold my oath to Constitution and country, I will vote to impeach Donald J. Trump.
We'll also speak with constitutional law expert John Boniface, who spearheaded the movement for Trump's impeachment, is co-author of The Constitution Demands It, The Case for the Impeachment of Donald Trump. Then the Justice Department Inspector General says the FBI used false information to obtain approval to wiretap a Trump campaign advisor.
We found, and as we outline here, are deeply concerned that so many basic and fundamental errors were made by three separate handpicked investigative teams on one of the most sensitive FBI investigations.
We'll speak with the ACLU. All that and more coming up. Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. In a historic vote on Wednesday, the House of Representatives impeached President Trump, marking only the third time in U.S. history a president has been impeached. This is House Speaker Nancy Pelosi opening the impeachment debate on the House floor Wednesday.
Our founders' vision of a republic is under threat from actions from the White House. That is why today, as Speaker of the House, I solemnly and sadly open the debate on the impeachment of the President of the United States. If we do not act now, we would be derelict in our duty. It is tragic that the President's reckless actions make impeachment necessary. He gave us no choice.
Lawmakers voted 230 to 197 in favor of the first article of impeachment against Trump, abuse of power. They voted 229 to 198 in favor of the second article of impeachment against the president, obstruction of Congress. The two articles center on how President Trump withheld military aid from Ukraine to pressure the Ukrainian president to investigate Trump's political rival, Joe Biden, and then how Trump tried to cover up his actions. Following the votes, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi said she would hold the articles back from being sent to the Senate until Democrats were convinced the Senate trial would be fair. Senate Majority Leader Republican Mitch McConnell has said he is not an impartial juror and that he would closely coordinate a Senate impeachment trial with the White House counsel's office, leading Democrats to accuse McConnell of trying to preside over a sham trial. We'll have more on the historic impeachment vote after headlines. On the same day as the impeachment vote, President Trump gave his longest rally speech to date in Battle Creek, Michigan. He lashed out at Democrats, the impeachment proceedings, the FBI, and the late Michigan Congressmember John Dingell, whose wife, Congresswoman Debbie Dingell, voted for Trump's impeachment Wednesday. This is Trump speaking about how Congresswoman Dingell called him to thank him for honoring her husband after his death.
She calls me up. It's the nicest thing that's ever happened. Thank you so much. John would be so thrilled. He's looking down. He'd be so thrilled. Thank you so much, sir. I said, that's okay. Don't worry about it. Maybe he's looking up. I don't know.
The late Congressman John Dingell was the longest-serving member of Congress in U.S. history, and he served in World War II. While the rest of Capitol Hill was focused on impeachment, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell pushed through 11 federal district judge nominations. McConnell's deal with Democrats to expedite the nominations of the judges is part of the Trump administration's sweeping effort to reshape the judicial system, pushing courts to the right. Justice Department Inspector General Michael Horowitz says the FBI should have considered halting its surveillance of Trump campaign aide Carter Page during testimony to the Senate Homeland Security and Governmental Affairs Committee Wednesday. Horowitz's testimony comes after the highly secretive Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, known as the FISA Court, issued a public order accusing the FBI of misleading the court to gain approval for the Carter Page wiretap and ordering the FBI to propose changes in how its investigators seek permission for domestic surveillance of U.S. citizens. We'll have more on this story later in the broadcast. Seven Democratic presidential candidates will participate in a televised debate tonight at Loyola Marymount University in Los Angeles. The debate will be co-hosted by PBS NewsHour and Politico and will begin at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. The candidates on stage will be Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, Joe Biden, Pete Buttigieg, Amy Klobuchar, Tom Steyer, and Andrew Yang. The Democratic National Committee has come under fierce criticism for its debate criteria, which excluded prominent candidates of color, Senator Cory Booker and Julian Castro. Booker and other presidential candidates have signed a letter to DNC Chair Tom Perez, urging the DNC to change its qualification criteria for upcoming debates in January and February. Tomorrow on Democracy Now!, we'll play highlights of the Los Angeles debate. In New Orleans, a federal appeals court has struck down a central part of the Affordable Care Act, ruling that requiring people to have health insurance is unconstitutional. The appeals court did not invalidate the rest of the law, although the ruling leaves the future of President Obama's signature health care law in limbo. 17 million Americans could lose their health care coverage through the Affordable Care Act if the law is thrown out entirely. In Australia, protesters have set up tents outside the Prime Minister's home to demand urgent action on climate change, as Australia recorded its hottest day ever on record. On Wednesday, the average temperature soared to 107.4 degrees Fahrenheit, beating out the previous record, which had been set on Tuesday, only 24 hours earlier. Uncontrolled wildfires are raging across Australia, sending thick black smoke billowing across the continent, with smoke alarms going off in homes and offices across Sydney. On Tuesday, ABC News journalists, that's Australian Broadcasting Corporation journalists, were forced to broadcast the nightly news outside after smoke from the nearby fires set off the studio's alarms in the capital, Canberra. This is 14-year-old Ambrose Hayes speaking at the protest outside the Australian Prime Minister's home.
We want to be listened to. We want a future. Yeah. And if our government doesn't act, there will be more protests like this. There have been so many recently, and this just shows how much of an issue this is.
A new study has found United Nations peacekeepers stationed in Haiti between 2004 to 2017 fathered and abandoned hundreds of children there. The study's based on interviews with over 2,000 Haitians who live near the UN peacekeepers' bases and who spoke about the sexual exploitation and abuse of Haitian women and girls as young as 11 years old. The study is the latest evidence of international peacekeepers' pattern of sexual abuse in Haiti, which included trading food for sex with women and children in desperate poverty. In the Democratic Republic of Congo, families are suing some of the world's biggest tech companies after their children were killed or injured working in the country's cobalt mines. The lawsuit accuses Apple, Google, Microsoft, Tesla, and others of knowing that the cobalt used in their products could be linked to child labor. The families say extreme poverty drove their children to work in the dangerous mines, where they were paid as little as $2 a day. Some of the children were buried alive in tunnel collapses, while others were paralyzed or maimed. Democratic Republic of Congo produces 60% of the global supply of cobalt, which is used to produce the lithium batteries that power electric cars, laptops, and smartphones. A former Argentine police officer accused of carrying out torture and crimes against humanity during Argentina's dictatorship has been extradited from France to Argentina. Mario Sandoval lived in France for more than 30 years, where he lectured at the New Sorbonne University. He was finally extradited Monday, more than a decade after his role in Argentina's brutal dictatorship was revealed by an investigation in the Argentine newspaper Página 12, or page 12. The Committee to Protect Journalists says at least 25 journalists were killed in 2019, and over 250 are in jail in relation to their work in countries around the world. The deadliest countries for journalists in 2019 were Syria and Mexico. The biggest jailer of journalists are China, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, and Egypt. In Bolivia, prosecutors have issued an arrest warrant for longtime Bolivian President Evo Morales, accusing the ousted leader of sedition and terrorism. Morales was forced to leave Bolivia after being ousted in what he and many others describe as a military coup. Morales says he has a right to return to Bolivia and help his Movement Towards Socialism party campaign in upcoming elections. This is Morales speaking from Argentina.
They need to let me enter Bolivia. I'm not a candidate. I won't be a candidate in these elections, but I have a right to participate in politics like any politician.
Back in the United States, the Supreme Court has upheld protections for people who sleep or camp outdoors after refusing to hear a case over whether cities could criminalize homelessness. The Supreme Court's refusal to hear the case leaves in place an appeals court ruling that says the Constitution does not allow cities to prosecute people for sleeping or camping outside unless the city provides shelter for every single unhoused person in their jurisdiction. The legal decision comes as soaring rents and deepening economic inequality have led homelessness rates to soar in some U.S. cities. To see our full report on homelessness in San Francisco, California, go to democracynow.org. In news on voting rights, New Jersey Governor Phil Murphy has signed legislation to restore voting rights to more than 80,000 residents on probation or parole. The measure will take effect in March. Meanwhile, in Georgia, officials have removed more than 300,000 registered voters from the rolls. Georgia officials say the voters were inactive and that the move is part of a routine maintenance. But voting rights activists say the purge only 3 months before Georgia's primary election is undemocratic and part of a longer history of voter suppression in Georgia. Uber's agreed to pay $4.4 million to settle sexual discrimination charges. The settlement stems from an investigation by the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission that found Uber, quote, permitted a culture of sexual harassment and retaliation against individuals who complained about such harassment. The video surveillance footage of serial pedophile Jeffrey Epstein's first reported suicide attempt in July is reportedly missing. Prosecutors say the missing video of the area around Epstein's jail cell inside the Manhattan Correctional Center on July 23rd cannot be located. Authorities have brought separate criminal charges against two prison guards who were on duty in August on the night Epstein reportedly hung himself. And in Wisconsin, a teenager is facing life in prison after she confessed to killing a 34-year-old man who she says raped her and trafficked her for sex. Randy Villar began sexually abusing Crystal Kaiser when she was 16 years old. He filmed the abuse. In February 2018, Villar was arrested on charges of child sexual assault, but he was then released without bail. Villar, who is white, remained free despite police having evidence he was sexually abusing a dozen black girls. In June 2018, Crystal killed him after she says he attacked her when she refused to have sex with him. Crystal is now facing charges of first-degree intentional homicide, which carries a mandatory life sentence in Wisconsin. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Nermeen Sheikh. Welcome to our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. In a historic vote Wednesday, the House of Representatives impeached President Trump, marking only the third time in U.S. history that a president has been impeached. This is House Speaker Nancy Pelosi.
On this vote, the yeas are 230, the nays are 197, present is one. Article 1 is adopted.
In a vote of 230 to 197, the House passed the first article of impeachment that accuses Trump of abuse of power. The House also approved the second article that charges him with obstructing Congress by refusing to cooperate with the impeachment investigation. The vote split along party lines after a debate that lasted the entire day as Congress members from both parties argued their case. This is Democratic Congress member John Lewis of Georgia.
Today, this day, we didn't ask for this. This is a sad day. It is not a day of joy. Our nation is founded on the principle that we do not have kings, we have presidents, and the Constitution is our compass. When you see something that is not right, not just, not fair, you have a moral obligation to say something, to do something. Our children and their children will ask us, what did you do? What did you say? For some, this vote may be hard, but we have a mission and a mandate to be on the right side of history.
Meanwhile, Republicans were dismissive of the charges against Trump. This is Georgia Republican Barry Loudermilk, who essentially compared Donald Trump to Jesus.
The Sixth Amendment guarantees the right of the defendant to face their accuser. But not only have the Democrats prohibited Republicans and the president from questioning the so-called whistleblower, his identity has been kept secret. Before you take this historic vote today, 1 week before Christmas, I want you to keep this in mind. When Jesus was falsely accused of treason, Pontius Pilate gave Jesus the opportunity to face his accusers. During that sham trial, Pontius Pilate afforded more rights to Jesus than the Democrats have afforded this president in this process.
Following the votes, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi said she would hold the articles back from being sent to the Republican-controlled Senate for a trial until Democrats were convinced that trial would be fair. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell has said he is not an impartial juror and that he would closely coordinate the Senate impeachment trial with the White House Counsel's Office, leading Democrats to accuse McConnell of trying to preside over a sham trial. Meanwhile, President Trump continues to deny any wrongdoing. On the same day as the impeachment vote, Trump gave his longest rally speech to date in Battle Creek, Michigan. He lashed out at Democrats, the impeachment proceedings, the FBI, and the late Michigan Congressman John Dingell, whose wife, Congressmember Debbie Dingell, voted for Trump's impeachment. This is Trump speaking about how Congresswoman Dingell called him to thank him for honoring her husband after his death.
She calls me up. It's the nicest thing that's ever happened. Thank you so much. John would be so thrilled. He's looking down. He'd be so thrilled. Thank you so much, sir. I said, that's okay. Don't worry about it. Maybe he's looking up. I don't know.
The late Michigan Congressmember John Dingell was the longest-serving member of Congress in U.S. history. His wife, Congresswoman Debbie Dingell, responded on Twitter to Trump, writing, Mr. President, let's set politics aside. My husband earned all his accolades after a lifetime of service. I'm preparing for the first holiday season without the man I love. You brought me down in a way you can never imagine, and your hurtful words just made my healing much harder, she wrote. At least two people in the packed arena at Trump's rally were removed after they held up a banner that said, Don the Con, you're fired. Trump also called a heckler a slob and a disgusting person and urged security officers of being politically correct and called on them to be stronger than that as they escorted her out.
Get her out of here. You're about to hear the greatest speech you've ever heard, and that's going to be the publicity because all the fake news back there will say massive riot. Massive riots. Fake news.
Well, for more, we go to Washington, D.C., where we're joined by Congressmember Pramila Jayapal, Democrat from Washington State. First, this is Congressmember Jayapal speaking on the House floor Wednesday.
Our founders entrusted us with the awesome responsibility of protecting our democracy, which gets its power not from the bloodlines of monarchs, but from the votes of we the people. And so today, to uphold my oath to Constitution and country, I will vote to impeach Donald J. Trump.
Congressmember Pramila Jayapal, Democrat from Washington State, welcome back to Democracy Now! It's the morning after.
Thank
Your
you,
thoughts
Amy.
On this historic day and what this means for the country.
This was an important moment for the Constitution, for our country, for accountability, and for defending democracy. And I'm really proud of all of our Democrats, including many of them in tough districts that Trump won, who put country over party and said, if we do not hold this president accountable for his abuses of power, we essentially let democracy die. That's not going to happen on our watch. Amy, it was surreal, though, you know, just sitting in the chamber yesterday, the 18 hours in Judiciary Committee when we marked up the articles of impeachment, the months of testimonies before that, listening to Republicans literally refuse to look at the facts, refuse to acknowledge that this president invited a foreign government to interfere in our elections. Not once, not twice, but three times that we know of, Ukraine unfolding right in front of us, and that he himself is the smoking gun. He came onto the White House lawn. He told us exactly what he wanted from President Zelensky of Ukraine. He said, I wanted him to open an investigation into the Bidens. And the idea that he would withhold this critically needed congressionally approved military aid to Ukraine, very fragile country fighting Russian aggression, desperately needing that aid, is really an affront. And then the final piece, of course, is his unprecedented obstruction of Congress, where, unlike even Nixon, I can't believe we're comparing in a good way to, in a bad way to Nixon, but unlike even Nixon or Clinton, this president refused to allow a single witness, a single document to come to us or to be released to us as we conducted this investigation. So two charges that he was impeached on yesterday by the House of Representatives for the third time only in the history of this country. That will be his shame, his stain, his legacy. That will be the first line of every article that's written about him. And I know it bothers him, regardless of what the Senate may do, regardless of whether Senate Republicans actually choose to put country over party, and to think about the effect, not just on them, their political districts, their reelections, or even on this president, but on the future of our democracy.
Well, and Representative Jayapal, there was only one Democratic Congress member who happens to be the only Democratic presidential candidate who abstained from the vote for impeachment, Tulsi Gabbard. Could you talk about your response to that?
I really think it was not a smart choice for her politically, and I don't know how she could do that. At the same time that she's running for president, if she can't make a decision about whether to vote yes or no on these articles of impeachment, I'm not sure how she intends to make those decisions in the White House. I thought that was disappointing. I like Tulsi Gabbard, but I thought that was very disappointing and, frankly, a cop-out. You know, these votes are votes of courage. They're votes of conscience. And I think that every single one of us, regardless of our districts, regardless of the politics, has to think about the oath that we swore to the Constitution and to the country when we took office. And I don't think people are looking for a present vote at this moment.
Well, the explanation she gave, just to be clear, for why she could not vote, she says, for impeachment, she said while she believes that Trump is guilty of wrongdoing, she couldn't vote yes because the process was too partisan and, quote, fueled by tribal animosities that have so gravely divided our country.
I know what she said, and I don't want to, you know, I don't want to continue to talk about her decision. I think she has to do that. I can just tell you that I think that this moment calls for us to make a judgment call, a moral call, a call of conscience to what we think is necessary going forward. The idea that it's too partisan, and this is something that Republicans have said as well, I would just say we have to put that on Republicans. You know, to sit there and listen to these Republicans make excuses for this president and his abuse of power, to me, is unconscionable. The bipartisanship in previous impeachments, the breaks of party, have come from the minority party. And so I think that this is very, very important for us to look at, that there are Republicans who I believe know that asking a foreign government to interfere in our elections. Remember what I said on the floor, that clip you played. You know, we don't derive our power in our democracy through the bloodlines of monarchs. It's through the votes of people. It's through the votes of we, the people, you, me, everybody who's watching right now. And if we are inviting, if the president of the United States is using his office to invite a foreign ally to, or coerce, I should say, in this case with Ukraine, to coerce a foreign ally to interfere in our elections, that's undermining our elections. And we have a lot of work to do to make sure our elections are free and fair in this country. But inviting a foreign ally, coercing a foreign ally, depending on which country we're talking about, to interfere in our elections is absolutely taking away the votes of the people. And then obstructing Congress on top of that is saying, I am above the checks and balances that the framers put into the Constitution.
I wanted to go to Texas Democrat Al Green, the first Congress member to call for Trump's impeachment from the House floor in 2017. This is Congressmember Green yesterday.
Shall any man be beyond justice? This is the question posed in 1787 by George Mason at the Constitutional Convention. Shall any man be beyond justice? Madam Speaker, if this president is allowed to thwart the efforts of Congress with a legitimate impeachment inquiry, the president will not only be above the law, he will be beyond justice. We cannot allow any person to be beyond justice in this country. In the name of democracy, on behalf of the Republic, and for the sake of the many who are suffering, I will vote to impeach, and I encourage my colleagues to do so as well.
That was Texas Democrat Al Green speaking on the House floor, standing next to a large picture of a migrant child weeping next to her mother. On Wednesday, Congressmember Green said he believes Trump can be impeached again if necessary.
The president can't contend that I can only be impeached once, and therefore I can do whatever I want now, and you won't be able to impeach me. That's ridiculous. It's as ridiculous as a lot of the other things that border on inanity that the president continues to wallow in. So, yes, this may not be the end of it. I don't say that it is or is not. I do say that the Constitution allows us to impeach a president multiple times if the president commits multiple impeachable acts.
So, Congressmember Pramila Jayapal, what do you say to this? I mean, he has been calling, Congressman Green has been calling this for the impeachment of Trump for 2 years, giving many different reasons. Chief among them, and he wrote this letter on December 4th to his fellow Congress members like you and everyone else, saying that he should be impeached for racism, for inciting violence. What about this possibility that Trump could be—I mean, now it's very narrow, these two articles of impeachment that the House has just voted on, but that he could be impeached again?
Well, it's certainly procedurally possible. I think that what we will see is more and more evidence coming out, not only on this charge, but on other things. We'll see some of the court cases starting to go through around his tax returns, around the emoluments clause, and we intend to continue to have hearings on those things in the Judiciary Committee. I know that the Intel Committee also will likely continue to have some hearings. I think that what you have to look at is the case that we have presented now to the Senate. How do we strengthen that as much as we possibly can? You know, at the end of the day, this president should be removed for abuse of power and obstruction of Congress at a minimum. But if he's removed, he's removed. So we don't need five articles to remove him on necessarily. And I think that what we need to focus on is how do we strengthen the case that we have? How do we make that the strongest possible case, the most unity, get some of the Republican senators? I remember hearing Jeff Flake say that if this was a secret ballot in the Senate, there would be 35 Republican senators who would vote against the president. And I would just say that that is You know, that's a stunning statement that people actually believe that the president has done wrong and should and is corrupt and should be impeached, and yet they're not willing to have the courage to do that because of their own political futures. So, you know, what occurred to me over the last, I don't know, 8 months, I guess, as I've been involved in all of this, and I've gone back and I've read all the documents around the framers and how they were thinking about the Constitution, and as imperfect as it was, all the fixes to the Constitution that have been fought for and won by a lot of folks of color, a lot of people who were the most vulnerable, the most left out. We've gone soft on what we think it takes to sustain a democracy. We've forgotten that this is not something that is sustained on its own. The Constitution is a connective and protective tissue that has allowed democracy to sustain. But if we refuse to uphold the Constitution, the switch from a democracy to a dictatorship or a monarchy happens very, very fast. And I think Americans and the U.S. senators who are representing them have to really think about what this means for our children, our children's children, and the future of this country. This is far more than about Donald Trump.
Well, following the votes for impeachment on Wednesday, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi said she would hold the articles back from being sent to the Senate until Democrats were convinced the trial would be fair. Senate Majority Leader Republican Mitch McConnell has said he is not an impartial juror and that he would closely coordinate a Senate impeachment trial with the White House Counsel's office, leading Democrats to accuse McConnell of trying to preside over a sham trial. So could you respond to that? And what the key differences are between McConnell and Schumer on how this impeachment trial should proceed in the Senate?
Yes. You know, it is absolutely outrageous and an affront to democracy, to the Constitution, to the people of the United States, for Mitch McConnell, who is essentially the foreman of the jury, the guy who actually makes all of the rules for how the trial is going to proceed in the Senate, to be coordinating with the defendant. I don't think there's an American out there who would think that that is fair. I just saw a poll late last night that said 71% of Americans across this country, across party, believe that we should have witnesses in the Senate. But they want a fair trial. They want to hear from some of these people who Trump has refused to allow to come and testify, and they have not done what other, you know, career Foreign Service people did in coming to testify. So Mitch McConnell is essentially allowing for a sham trial to occur. And yet all of them are going to have to swear an oath that says that they're impartial, which means that they will be lying because so many of them have said already that they believe that we don't need to hear from witnesses, that they're coordinating with the defendant. And so what Nancy Pelosi is saying is, she is under no obligation to immediately send over the articles of impeachment and name the impeachment managers. What she's saying is she wants to make sure that this is actually going to be a real trial with witnesses, with the facts presented, with adequate time. And those were some of the things that Senator Schumer laid out in his letter. At the end of the day, it's going to be the folks who are out there who have to demand from their senators, and there are some vulnerable senators. I don't think Mitch McConnell, if he wants to preserve any kind of a Senate majority, I don't think he can afford to have a sham trial, though he certainly seems to be trying to do that. So that's why Nancy Pelosi is saying, we're going to hold on to the articles of impeachment for a little bit. We're going to see what the Senate comes back with in terms of agreed upon rules of how this trial is going to be conducted before I name impeachment managers and send them in. If she doesn't know what she's really going to be arguing and in what context, it's absolutely, I believe, the right thing for her to do to hold
this. I mean,
this
is clearly uncharted territory. Obviously, this historic moment, the impeachment of Donald Trump. In an odd way, Democrats are pushing for what Trump wants. He didn't want to be impeached, but he wants a long trial that not only acquits him, but somehow in his mind exonerates him. Now, Mitch McConnell has said, no, we want a very short trial. We just want to acquit him at the beginning. This issue of witnesses, both Lindsey Graham, McConnell, all called for witnesses when it came to the impeachment of President Clinton, but now are saying they're shutting it down and they won't have witnesses. Now, how does House Speaker Nancy Pelosi get any kind of guarantee? I mean, you're talking about these two sort of sovereign bodies. This has never happened before.
Yeah, I really excellent points. You know, the hypocrisy here, and I will say on the Democratic side, too, you know, you see some Democrats from previous impeachments making arguments and arguing the other way. But never in the history of this country has a president faced impeachment and been so obstructionist to Congress. That is a fact. I think that, you know, Mitch McConnell is going to have to be pushed by his senators to do something that is considered more fair. Is it going to be perfectly fair? I don't think so. It is ironic that, you know, President Trump probably is the person who wouldn't want these articles to be held for too long, because what he wants, as you said, is to be acquitted. We are not going to allow for witnesses to be called who have nothing to do with the matter at hand. And that is, of course, what President Trump wants. So I don't know how this will all play out. It is really uncharted territory, because we have the most extreme bully, the most extreme shredder of our Constitution and our democracy, and one of the most cruel people that I have seen, a person who only thinks of himself in the White House. And obviously, these articles are narrow, but there is a pattern of conduct. There is a moral lack that crosses over so many of these things, from his policies, which is not what we are impeaching him on, to his abuse of power and his obstruction of Congress, which is what we are impeaching him on.
Well, Representative Jayapal, before we end, I just wanted to ask about what appears to be a somehow paradoxical response to this impeachment inquiry, which is that a Gallup poll, a new Gallup poll that was revealed just yesterday morning, Wednesday morning, before the impeachment vote happened, found that Trump's approval rating has been increasing. It's gone up from 39% to 45%. It also showed support for Trump's impeachment and removal decreasing from 52% to 46%. Your response to that, and the fact that some are saying that this long, drawn-out impeachment inquiry is actually strengthening President Trump?
Well, two things. One, I think polling is not static. I look at it because it's out there and it's interesting to look at, but it is often changed by how leaders lead. And if there were enough, you know, even just a handful of Republicans who were willing to do what is right for the country and lead, I think you would see that polling shift pretty quickly. Remember, when Richard Nixon was impeached, it wasn't until the final days that polling dramatically shifted. Here, we have a very odd situation where the first and best witness to our case came on very early in the process, went on national television and told the American people exactly what Donald J. Trump did and wanted, and that was Donald J. Trump. He is the smoking gun in this situation. So people who are looking for more evidence somewhere else should just look at his words consistently, as well as his actions and the corroborating testimony. So I think polling does change. But the other thing that I would just say is it is a remarkable statement that half of the country wants to see, you know, just under half of the country wants to see President Trump removed from office. That is, those are stunning numbers. And I think sometimes we look at the opposite and we say, how come the numbers aren't greater? How could these people stick with the president? But that is a remarkable number of people who want this president impeached. And remember, in 2018, the American people voted in a House majority of Democrats because they wanted checks and balances. And I think that they are smarter than what Donald Trump gives them credit for. I'm not saying this is going to be easy, whether he's removed or not, if we have to go through a 2020 election because the Senate refuses to be courageous. The reality is that we have to continue to emphasize to the American people that if you don't have checks and balances, you don't have a democracy. If you don't have free and fair elections, you don't have a democracy. So if we want a democracy, we have to be willing to stand up for it. There may need to be people in the streets consistently. You know, I'm an organizer and an activist, and I believe that that matters. We have to hold this president accountable.
We want to thank you so much for being with us. Democratic Congress member Pramila Jayapal speaking to us from Washington, D.C., though she represents Seattle in Washington State. When we come back, we'll continue to look at impeachment with constitutional attorney and political activist John Boniface, who is co-author of a book on the impeachment of Donald Trump. Stay with us.
A man is placed upon the steps. A baby cries, and high above you can hear the church bell. The heaviness of it settles in, and somewhere you can hear it, a little sing. Then it's one foot, then the other, as you step out on the road. You step out on the road. How much weight? And it's how long and how far and how many times. Oh, before it's too late.
Calling All Angels by Jane Seibert and Katie Lang. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
In a historic vote Wednesday, the House of Representatives impeached President Trump, marking only the third time in U.S. history that a president has been impeached. By a vote of 230 to 197, the House passed the first article of impeachment that accuses Trump of abuse of power. It also approved the second article that charges him with obstructing Congress by refusing to cooperate with the impeachment investigation.
For more, we're joined by John Boniface, who spearheaded the fight for impeachment as co-founder and president of Free Speech for People, attorney and political activist specializing in constitutional law and voting rights, a co-author of The Constitution Demands It, the case for the impeachment of Donald Trump. He's joining us from his home in Amherst, Massachusetts. John, welcome back to Democracy Now! So often when history is told, it is written by those in power. Of course, it's the House that has just impeached President Trump. But you've been part of a movement for years that has been demanding this. Can you respond to what's happened and what you want to see next?
Well, thank you, Amy, for having me. We certainly have applauded members of Congress for standing up for our Constitution and our democracy at this critical moment in history, following their oath to preserve and protect the Constitution. But you're right, this is a movement that has led to this moment. Millions of Americans all over the nation who have demanded that their members of Congress do the right thing and stand up to defend our Constitution. We launched our campaign, co-launched it on the day of the inauguration of Donald Trump in January 2017 because of this president's refusal to divest from his business interests all over the world and engaging in treating the Oval Office as a profit-making enterprise at the public expense. He has gone on to commit many other impeachable offenses, and this pattern of abuse of power is why this president must be held accountable. So while we support the articles of impeachment that the Congress has just the House of Representatives has just passed, we also believe it's important to hold this president accountable for all of his high crimes, not just those associated with the Ukraine scandal.
Well, John Boniface, there seems to be almost near universal consensus that the Senate will not, in fact, vote to impeach him. So could you talk about what the effect on him and his reputation might be with this long-drawn-out impeachment inquiry?
I think, first of all, it's important to set the precedent that no president is above the law, and that this president, this lawless president who has so defied our Constitution and engaged in this pattern of abuse of power, must be held accountable. And that accountability begins with the House of Representatives issuing these articles of impeachment. I do agree that we need to demand a full and fair trial out of the United States Senate, and that we cannot allow the kangaroo court that Mitch McConnell appears to be preparing for. And that demand needs to be made again by we the people. This can't be a bystander process where we watch it on television or listen to it on the radio. We need to participate and be in the streets and demand that our senators do the right thing and be on the right side of history. But even if the Senate does not vote to convict and remove, the precedent that has been set is critically important, that these charges have been issued against this president and that he will be held accountable in history. And, you know, we are facing a dangerous moment right now where we have a lawless president who is so willing to rig the next election, to trample on our Constitution, that we all have to be vigilant. And that starts with demanding that there be a full and fair trial and conviction and removal of this president.
So what do you think? You're a constitutional lawyer. Very quickly, what Nancy Pelosi is doing right now, refusing to transfer the articles of impeachment, right? He's been impeached. The Senate would decide whether he would be removed, but not even to let them have it. How does she get a guarantee of what they're going to do? And then I want to ask you about Al Green, him saying that we can impeach him again and again, who clearly was for, as your organization has been for, and the movement has been for, articles of impeachment that included many other issues.
Yes, well, Speaker Pelosi is right to demand a full and fair trial out of the Senate, as we all are who care about this Constitution, and to hold back the articles until that is guaranteed, I think, is a wise move, but not to hold them back forever. These articles must be ultimately submitted to the Senate, and every senator must be put on record of where they stand with respect to this president's abuse of power. So that has to happen. As far as Congressman Green, you know, he's an American hero. He stood up first in the United States House of Representatives to demand that this president be held accountable through the impeachment process. And we fully agree with him that there is nothing in the Constitution that says that the U.S. House of Representatives can only impeach once during a presidential term. This president has committed multiple impeachable offenses, including his racist abuses of power, including his cruel and unconstitutional imprisonment of children and their families at the southern border, including his obstruction of justice. The list goes on, and this president ought to be held accountable for the full range of his abuses of power. So if Congressman Green decides that he's going to push for new articles of impeachment on the floor of the U.S. House of Representatives, we'll be right there by him to defend and support that.
John Bonifacio, I want to thank you for being with us, co-founder and president of Free Speech for People, co-author of The Constitution Demands It, the case for the impeachment of Donald Trump. When we come back, the Justice Department Inspector General says the FBI used false information to obtain approval to wiretap a Trump campaign advisor. Stay with us. We're going to speak to the ACLU.
My time, but in our sons and daughters' time, when you get the feeling, call and you got a room. Meantime, we're cutting our hands at the kebab shop in the streets of fear. We're getting all our best taekwondo moves on a barrel of beer. We're trying to get a signal on a regular FM. Do the TTI of a CNN. Sucking the wine right out of the vine. Spitting it out again. Grooving, let's cut out of the scene. Go grooving. Grooving, let's cut out of the scene. Go grooving.
Yalla Yalla by Joe Strummer and the Mescaleros. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nirmeet Sheikh. You can put this next story in the category of why while you may have been distracted by the historic impeachment that took place yesterday, this also happened in Washington.
Justice Department Inspector General Michael Horowitz said Wednesday that the FBI should have considered halting its surveillance of a Trump campaign aide after learning accusations against him may not be credible. Horowitz made the comments while testifying to the Senate Homeland Security Committee, accusing the FBI of using false information to obtain approval to wiretap Trump campaign advisor Carter Page and raising wider concerns about the agency's use of surveillance. His testimony came a day after the highly secretive Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, known as the FISA Court, issued a public order accusing the FBI of misleading the court to gain approval to wiretap Page and ordering the FBI to propose changes in how its investigators seek permission for domestic surveillance of U.S. citizens by January. The court first approved the FBI's wiretapping Page in October 2016 and extended its order three times in 2017.
This comes a week after the IG, the Inspector General Michael Horowitz, first issued a report finding a series of inaccuracies and omissions in the FBI surveillance application process. The American Civil Liberties Union responded to the report, tweeting, "The concerns the Inspector General identifies apply to intrusive investigations of others, including especially Muslims, and far better safeguards against abuse are necessary," unquote. Well, for more, we're joined by Ashley Gorski, staff attorney with the National Security Project at the ACLU. Ashley, thanks so much for joining us again. So while you were watching something else yesterday to the world, this other testimony happened. And while there are many who might be horrified at Trump's actions overall, this issue that he also has raised, that the ACLU joins in concern with, talk about the level of surveillance that the FBI engaged with. Talk about what happened with Carter Page and why you're so concerned.
Sure. So the surveillance at issue takes place under the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, and it's an incredibly intrusive form of surveillance with inadequate safeguards. The Horowitz report identified several significant errors and omissions in the FBI's surveillance applications to the secret court that presides over this surveillance, the FISA court. And this is why the ACLU is called for fundamental FISA reform. We've been calling for this reform for decades, but the Horowitz report, in many respects, illustrates the dangers of this secretive, one-sided process whereby the government applies to the court for surveillance and there's no sufficient adversarial check on the government's surveillance activities.
In lay terms, explain what happened to Carter Page and who he is.
Sure. So Carter Page was an advisor to the Trump campaign, and he had been on and off the government's radar for several years preceding his involvement with the Trump campaign. The FBI eventually sought an application with the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court to surveil his communications on the basis that the FBI believed he was a foreign agent for Russia. He was an agent of a foreign power. And as a result, it sought broad latitude to wiretap his communications. They did so shortly after he left the Trump campaign.
And what do you mean, foreign agent?
Essentially acting on behalf of Russia.
That he was being paid by them.
And it wouldn't necessarily have to involve payment, but, yes, acting on behalf of Russia.
Well, the Bureau, the FBI, has said that the conduct detailed in the report is, quote, unacceptable and unrepresentative of the FBI as an institution. Your response, is that your sense?
The conduct is certainly unacceptable, but it remains to be seen whether this conduct is actually unrepresentative. And this point bears emphasis. The Carter Page investigation involved an incredibly sensitive surveillance target, an individual who was associated with a presidential campaign. When the stakes were highest, the FBI failed, and it failed repeatedly to ensure that its surveillance application was accurate. And it begs the question, what errors and omissions are lurking in the FBI's surveillance applications in more ordinary cases? And the ACLU has called for reform of this process, including requiring disclosure to individuals who are prosecuted with the aid of FISA surveillance, requiring disclosure of the application so that defendants who are prosecuted using the surveillance have the opportunity to challenge the FBI's errors and omissions. Without this kind of disclosure, it's impossible for any particular individual to know whether there are misstatements in the surveillance applications.
James Comey was interviewed by Chris Wallace on Fox, and he said, now he was head of the FBI, I was wrong. I was overconfident in the procedures that the FBI and Justice had built over 20 years. I thought they were robust enough. He's talking about the IG now, the Inspector General. He was right. There was real sloppiness. So explain what he means. I mean, he was in charge. They were applying to the FISA court. And then make it broader than Carter Page. Talk about who usually gets brought before the FISA court, whether they know it or not.
Of course. I mean, there is tremendous secrecy shrouding the government's FISA applications, but based on the government's surveillance activities more broadly, we know that Muslims in particular are disproportionately targeted for FISA surveillance, and increasingly Chinese Americans appear to be targeted for this kind of surveillance as well. And what I think Comey is speaking to is more than sloppiness. I mean, he characterizes it as sloppiness, and it was certainly that, but these are profound errors. As just one example, the initial surveillance application relied on reporting from Christopher Steele, a former British intelligence agent. In subsequent applications, the FBI did not reveal the fact that it had interviewed Steele's primary source, and the primary source had contradicted Steele's assertions. The FBI made no mention of that. It just said that Steele's primary source was truthful and cooperative. And without raising that conflict to the FISA court, the FISA court has no way to second-guess Steele's representations. And that, again, illustrates the importance of adversarial review, which you would have in an ordinary criminal case.
Well, you've said that it remains to be seen how representative this case is of the FBI's actions. How will you find out whether it is representative or not?
Horowitz has committed to conducting an audit of traditional FISA surveillance that's targeted toward Americans. One of the challenges with conducting that kind of audit, though, is that he isn't going to be able to devote the same amount of resources into doing the kind of deep dive into those applications. And in many respects, it will involve kind of double-checking the paperwork that already exists. And that sort of double-checking won't necessarily reveal the types of errors and omissions that were revealed as a result of his deep dive into the Carter Page applications. And again, that is why disclosure to defense attorneys and defendants who are prosecuted with the aid of this surveillance is absolutely essential so that there can be a more robust accounting for the FBI's surveillance practices and the mistakes and the misrepresentations it's making in its applications.
Is FISA court essentially a rubber stamp to what the intelligence agencies, the FBI, when they appeal to them? And do you think the FISA court should be abolished, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, this highly secretive court?
It's certainly a problematic institution. I wouldn't necessarily characterize it as a rubber stamp. There is some degree of scrutiny of the government's applications and an iterative process whereby those applications might be modified to some degree. But the real issue here is that it cannot continue in its current form. It needs to be fundamentally reformed. Another critical reform would involve Congress requiring the appointment of an amicus, especially in cases involving sensitive investigations, cases implicating significant First Amendment interests, cases implicating individuals who are associated with political campaigns. In that context in particular, you need to open up these proceedings to the light of some scrutiny from a neutral third party, at the very least.
So to bring this back to President Trump, though this is usually targeted against those he targets, like, for example, Muslims, this is when he said, I was wiretapped by President Obama.
Much of the current debate has its genesis in those initial tweets in which President Trump said that his wires were tapped. And, of course, the Inspector General found no evidence that President Trump was, in fact, a target of the FISA surveillance at issue.
Well, we will continue to follow this. Ashley Gorski, I want to thank you for being with us, staff attorney with the National Security Project at the American Civil Liberties Union. And that does it for our show. Democracy Now! Is produced by Mike Burke, Dina Gozder, Nermin Jay, Carla Wills, Tammy Warrenoff, Libby Rainey, Sam Alkoff, John Hamilton, Ravi Karan, Hani Massoud, Jarena Nadura, Tamari Astudio, Adriana Contreras, and Maria Tarasena. tune in to our holiday shows. On Christmas Day, we'll be bringing you a special on Toni Morrison, the celebration of her life that took place at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine with Oprah Winfrey. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. Thanks so much.